Tonight I thought I would talk about abusing God's grace. You know, sometimes we abuse God's grace and we don't even know that we're doing it. Because it's unintentional, some of the things that we do. Sometimes we misdirect our priorities, so to speak. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about this tonight. Best I can. With the first definition of grace having to do with the unmerited favor and mercy of God toward us, and that this is the grace that we are actually saved by with our Lord Jesus. What will happen next is some Christians is that they will then try to start to take advantage of this grace. Often when that happens, this is people who call themselves Christians, but who don't really worship God. You know, they call themselves Christians, but are they really Christians? But do we take advantage of it sometime? But these folks, they will start to try and abuse it. Once we realize that all of our past, present, and future sins will be fully forgiven under the blood that Jesus had already shed for us, it becomes very easy to want to get lazy and then be tempted to want to push the envelope of God the Father, to see exactly what we can get away with and how far we can push certain things with Him. Have you done that before? Anybody in here been a kid before? No? That's right. If you don't believe it, ask some of your teenagers. They thought you fell off a turnip truck as a grown-up, didn't they? You know, Mom, you don't understand. Dad, you don't understand. But the thing of it is, as kids, sometimes we see how far we can push that envelope, don't we? How much we can get away with. Well, as God's children, sometimes that happens as well. Sometimes it's unintentional. Other times, it's intentional. In the Old Testament, in Ezekiel chapter 16, chapter 20 and chapter 23, God explained His grace with the Israelites and how they became too comfortable and abused His grace. Then He explained how He dealt with that situation, how He will deal with that kind of situation with us today. You know, Romans tell us in chapter 3 and verse 23 that we all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But then in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8, it tells us that it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from ourselves, it is the gift of God. Tonight I want to focus on Ezekiel chapter 16. Ezekiel chapter 16, the prophet Ezekiel is ordered by God to show the people of Jerusalem that their sins deserve punishment, but He had compassion on them. For those of us who were in Ken's class back this summer, this is, you know, during the Intertestament period, the Jews were captured by the Babylonians during that time period. And some of them, if you remember in his class, stayed in Babylon, and others of them went to Jerusalem. The ones that the prophet Ezekiel, God sent the prophet Ezekiel to talk to are the ones in Jerusalem during this time period. In this chapter, he compared Jerusalem to an unfaithful vine. He compared her to an adulteress that injustice should be abandoned and exposed, and shows them their abominations. For the sake of time, we're just going to look at chapter 16 tonight. So if you want to read along with me, let's start in chapter 16. It's kind of a long chapter, quite a bit of reading, but I'm not going to read each and every verse out of it. But we are going to read the first 14 for starters. The first 14 verses here is where Israel is actually lavished with God's grace and compassion. Israel actually got everything from God that she will need. And you'll find that my lesson is written kind of using two versions. You know, most of you know me, know I use the New King James Version most all the time, but some of tonight's going to be out of NIV. Because of the long reading, I'm reading out of the NIV. The word of the Lord came to me, son of man, me being Ezekiel. Confront Jerusalem with her detestable practices and say, this is what the Lord, the sovereign Lord, says to Jerusalem. Your ancestry and birth were in the land of the Canaanites. Your father was an Amorite and your mother a Hittite. On the day you were born, your court was not cut, nor were you washed with water to make you clean, nor were you rubbed with salt or wrapped in cloths. No one looked on you with pity or had compassion enough to do any of these things for you. Rather, you were thrown out into the open field, for on the day you were born, you were despised. Then I passed by and saw you kicking about in your blood. And as you lay there in your blood, I said to you, live. I made you grow like a plant of the field. You grew up and developed and became the most beautiful of jewels. Your breasts were formed and your hair grew. You who were naked and bare. Later I passed by, and when I looked at you and saw that you were old enough for love, I spread the corner of my garment over you and covered your nakedness. I gave you my solemn oath and entered into a covenant with you, declares the sovereign Lord, and you became mine. I bathed you with water and washed the blood from you and put ointments on you. I clothed you with an embroidered dress, put leather sandals on you. I dressed you in fine linen and covered you with the costly garments. I adorned you with jewelry. I put bracelets on your arms and a necklace around your neck, and I put a ring on your nose, earrings on your ears, and a beautiful crown on your head. So you were adorned with gold and silver. Your clothes were of fine linen and costly fabric, and embroidered cloth. Your food was fine flour, honey, and olive oil. You became very beautiful and rose to be a queen, and your fame spread among the nations on account of your beauty. Because the splendor I have given you made your beauty perfect, declares the sovereign Lord. So you see right there, the Lord gave her everything she needed, made her look good, exalted her. But sometimes that happens to us, right? We get a great job, we go to college, graduate, top of our class, get this great job, start making this great money, and think, we did it. It was all because of something I did. And we forget that the Lord God made it possible for us to do that. Made it possible for us to do that. Sometimes we become conceited and arrogant, thinking it's only we who have done well for ourselves, and not thinking that it was God who allowed it. Not thinking that it's God who can take it away from us in the blink of an eye. Let's take a look at verses 15 through 34. And we're going to read, I'll skip around on these, and I'll tell you what verses I'm reading. So let's take a look at 15, 16, 20, 22, 23, 24. Because during this time period, what's going to happen is Israel is going to fall from grace. Israel is going to fall from grace. And it happens to us sometimes when we become a little arrogant and a little conceited and not giving God the glory as we ought to. But you trusted in your beauty and used your fame to become a prostitute. You lavished your favors on anyone who passed by, and your beauty became this, or became his. You took some of your garments to make gaudy high places where you carried on your prostitution. Such things should not happen, nor should they ever occur. Let's drop down to verse 20. And you took your sons and daughters, whom you bore to me, and sacrificed them as food to the idols. Was your prostitution not enough? You slaughtered my children and sacrificed them to the idols. And all your detestable practices and your prostitution, you did not remember the days of your youth, when you were naked and bare, kicking about in your blood. See, God doesn't like it when we forget about him, but he certainly doesn't like it when we start doing things that he detests. Let's take a look at 23 and 24 real quick here. Woe, woe to you, declares the sovereign Lord. In addition to all your other wickedness, you built a mound for yourself and made a lofty shrine in every public square. You made a lofty shrine. Do you remember what happened when God brought the Israelites out of Egypt? And Moses went up on Mount Sinai before he got back. What happened? They built themselves a golden calf, didn't they? Well, God says in Exodus chapter 20, verses 3 and 4, with the Ten Commandments, he says, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. And then in verse 5, he said, For I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God. They have started their fall from grace. And then when we take a look at verses 35 through 39, you will see that God removes his grace from the Israelites. Sometimes we don't like to think that God will do that, but we can't fall from grace. We have to stay good and stay in favor with our Lord. 35. Therefore, you prostitute, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says. Because you poured out your wealth and exposed your nakedness in your promiscuity with your lovers, and because of all your detestable idols, and because you gave them your children's blood, therefore I am going to gather all your lovers with whom you found pleasure, those you loved as well as those you hated. I will gather them against you from all around and will strip you in front of them, and they will see all your nakedness. I will sentence you to the punishment of women who commit adultery and who shed blood. I will bring upon you the blood vengeance of my wrath and jealous anger. Then I will hand you over to your lovers, and they will tear down your mounds and destroy your lofty shrines. They will strip you of your clothes and take your fine jewelry and leave you naked and bare. You see, God allows things like that to happen when we don't do what we are supposed to do. When we are disobedient to him, and when we don't give him the glory. Do we think God has changed today? I think he's still the same. In fact, Malachi chapter 3 and verse 6 says, for I am the Lord, I do not change. It reads just like that. So we know that God is same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And Ken said in his sermon this morning, he's talking about the great I am. He's called the great I am because I am God in the past, God of the present, and God of the future. And he doesn't change. The Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 5, verse 20, where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. But that radical concept opens a theological floodgate. The biblical writer Jude warned that it's possible to change the grace of our God into a license for immorality. In verse 4 of Jude, he's talking about certain men who call themselves Christians, who have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation. Ungodly men who turned the grace of our God into mutinous and deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. The men Jude's talking about here are teachers, albeit false teachers of the Word of God. In their minds, they're thinking, and sometimes they think that, if we've got grace, why do I have to be good, right? It's going to be covered. Why be good if we're going to be forgiven? But what we have to do is not fall in that trap, because we're all teachers in one way or another, aren't we? Whether standing in front of a group, doing a one-on-one Bible study, or by our actions and the way we live our lives, we're all teachers. In reading that passage, 20 and 21 of Romans chapter 5, the Bible says, "Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace abounded much more." Verse 21, "So that as sin reigned in death, even so grace might reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Notice the first verse, Paul is telling us that though we've been saved by God's grace, this does not mean that we can go back to sinning again. Paul is flat out telling us that we cannot use the grace of God that we've just been saved with as an excuse and a license to keep on sinning. Above, we talked about the abominations of the Jews in Jerusalem. But listen to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 while talking to the church in Corinth. In verses 9 and 11, he says, "Or do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." Verse 11, "And that is what some of you were. But you were washed, you were sanctified, and you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." But we cannot go back to sinning. Cannot go back to living that life and expect God's grace to continue to cover those sins, can we? God expects us to be obedient to His Word and glorify Him with our actions. He tells us that we have now died to sin and thus should no longer live and wallow in it. God's grace is not an open invitation to keep on sinning. The second verse then tells us that God's grace has now set us free from sin and the power it used to have over us. But this verse is specifically telling us that sin shall not have dominion over us. And that we cannot go back to sinning again just because we have now been saved by His grace. In Romans chapter 6, Paul spoke directly to the point. He said, "Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?" He gave a short, explosive answer. The New King James Version puts it this way: "Certainly not." And used an analogy that starkly contrasts death and life. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? See, no Christian resurrected to new life should continue to live in sin. Yet wickedness does not always seem to have the stench of death about it, does it? Sin can be downright appealing. It looks good to us. We've heard the old saying, how Satan reels us in, gives us everything we want, makes it look good for us, and once he has us. You know? Sometimes we develop hobbies, thinking they're innocent, and there's nothing sinful about them, and we sometimes put them before worshiping our God. But where's God in our priorities? Our innocent hobbies are our jobs, recreational activities, and other activities and events can send the wrong signal about our priorities. Or perhaps those things have actually become our priorities. Something to think about. Is it possible that our loyalties to others are misdirected? 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9 tells us to be careful not to become a stumbling block to the weak. Don't get me wrong. Christianity is not a sad, morbid religion. It's one of joy and happiness. Christians can do anything that is true, honorable, just, pure, lovely, and of good report, says Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8. But we just don't want to hold a higher priority to those things than we do to our Lord Jesus, do we? We want to make sure that we keep our Lord as our first priority, as our highest priority. Paul recognized some of these things, so he advised in Romans 6, verses 11 through 14, he said, "Likewise you also reckon yourselves to be dead, indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lusts, and do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. But present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace." If we truly grasp the wonder of God's love for us, we will spend our days trying to fathom His grace, how to understand His grace, and share it with others, not exploit it. Well, let's return to tonight's main question. Are we abusing His grace? Are we justifying our choices by saying, "Oh, it's okay, it's only one time." But then, it's just a little lie. But then sometimes that little lie turns into a little bit bigger lie, and a little bit bigger lie. Sometimes we have to tell another lie to cover up the other lies that we've told, and it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger, doesn't it? Sometimes we say it's not a big deal. I'm forgiven. But we have to remember, in the meantime, God may see things a little bit differently than we do. In fact, take up the little bit term. I'm sure He sees things differently than we do, if we look at it that way. Again, Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 16 and 17, "Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person." The abuse of grace is not good. Sometimes we get close to the edge, not knowing it. But if we stay close to God, stay close to God's Word, we'll know not to do that. Tonight I've spoken about the abuse of God's grace this evening. I want you to know that mostly I'm talking about intentional sinning. Intentional sinning. Because we do have forgiveness. And we do have God's grace. And grace can cover unintentional sinning. But we have to remember, we have to be sincere. Because none of us is perfect, and we will sin, won't we? So, that's my lesson this evening. So I'm going to ask Jeff to come up. If anybody has need of prayer tonight, I'm going to ask you to come forward as Jeff leads us in the invitation song.